Welcome everyone to the second book reading session. Today's reader is Professor Shiva Malapaka, who is currently an assistant professor at IIIT Bangalore. He has worked for his PhD at the Max Planck Institute for Plasma Physics. He got his degree from the University of Beirut in Germany. And his thesis was on simulations of three-dimensional magneto-hydrodynamic turbulence. He has a very rich postdoctoral experience, which includes work at University of Colorado in Boulder, USA, UPMC in Paris, University of Leeds in UK, TIFR, TCIS in Hyderabad, and University of Rome. His research interests are in the areas of three-dimensional simulations of hydrodynamic and magneto-hydrodynamic turbulence, simulations of magnetic confinement of plasma, and n-body simulations for planetary formation. The good thing is he's not talking on all that, because these are all difficult terms for, I'm sure, many of us here. Professor Shiva is an art and literature enthusiast. He enjoys a good book, music, dance, play, or a movie. And when he likes something, he is in the habit of disseminating it and talking about it. And that is what he'll be doing today. He'll be talking about the Telugu classic, Mahaprasthanam, written by Sri Rangam Srinivas Rao, and who has been hailed as one of the most celebrated poets in Telugu literature. So over to Professor Shiva. Professor Shiva, all yours. Please, you may please start.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Amit, for that wonderful introduction. I am going to speak about the book Mahaprasthanam today. This is the book Mahaprasthanam in yellow, and it's also about the poet, the great Sri Sri Mahakavi. Now, one provocative question before I can start. How would any poet be remembered in death? Say, for example, if you are being cremated, how would your cremation be going on? For Sri Sri, it was that in Chennai, various poets and writers from various parts of Andhra Pradesh went to Chennai, and when he was being burnt on the pyre, they sung his poems. I have no idea of any other poet who received such an honor from any in any other language or in any other part of the world. Before I can start with the book itself, I just want to introduce what Telugu language is. It's a language of 56 symbols or letters, as you can see on the left side of the screen. It has evolved grammar and rules. It is called the Italian of the East. The reason it is called Italian of the East is it is the Ajanta Bhasha, meaning that all the letters end with an oval, A-E-I-O-U. If you talk to any, Telugu person, he would say Garu, Andi. Those ends are all in the ovals. So, and the poetry in Telugu has always followed rigid chandas until the beginning of the 19th century. It started in around 1100 AD. With Adikavi, we call Nannayya, who wrote a part of the Andhra Mahabharata, which is the translation of the Vyasa Bharata, and he wrote the first 2.5 parvas. He expired while writing the third parva. So he wrote the Adi Parva and the Sabha Parva, and also a part of Aranya Parva, where Pandavas were in the jungle. Most of the Mahabharata was then completed by what a person called or the poet called Tikkana, he is called Vaganusasana, because most of our Telugu words and say grammar, literature, usage, we owe it to Tikkana in terms of the rich say dictionary of words he created. He is, say, you can call him equivalent of Shakespeare for English, who created many words for English. Okay, and the third, but he did not touch the third parva, which he thought was jinx, as Nanaya died writing the third parva, and it was later finished by another poet called Erra Pragada. And these three poets spanned over 300 years in three different parts of Andhra, the current Andhra Pradesh. Nanaya belonged to Rajahmundry. He belonged to the Godavari coast. Tikkana belonged to Nelluru, the Penna coast. And Erra Pragada was also very close to Nellore, but not exactly to Nellore. But they had almost 100 years gap between them. So between 1100 and 1400, the book Andhra Mahabharatam got written. Now, this book is full of, the chanda, Sanskrit chandas. So the first ever poem that was written, I just want you to listen. You could see the heavy influence of Sanskrit in it.
Shrivani Girijaschiraya Dadhato Vaksho Mukhangeshu Ye Lokanam Sthitimavahantya Vihitam Stri Pumsa Yogodbhavam Te Vedatraya Murtaya Stri Purusha Sampujita Vassurair Bhuyasuhu Purushottamam Bujabhavashri Kandharashreyase.
As you can see, Nanaya was praying the Trimurti and the three lady goddesses before he could start writing the poems. Now, this particular thing, comes to or emphasizes my point, heavy influence of Sanskrit and Sanskrit grammar and the chandas. Now, how would any chandas look like? Okay, so let me give an example. Like, so this particular poem by Tikkana is in the parva where Krishna goes to the Dhritarashtra Sabha to ask for the five villages. And there he sees Bhishma and says, Sarapu Dharmamu Vimala Satyamun పాపము చేత బొంకు చేత భారము పొందలేక చెడబారినదై యవస్థ దక్షులెవ్వారులుపేక్ష చేసి అదివారల చేటగును గాని ధర్మ నిస్తారకమయ్యు సత్య శుభదాయకమయ్యును దైవముండెడు. వాట్ డస్ హీ సే? హీ సేస్, ఇఫ్ పీపుల్ లైక్ యూ హూ ఆర్ వైజ్ ఆర్ అనేబుల్ టు డిఫెండ్ ద ధర్మ అండ్ see anyaya happen in front of you, then it is harmful to you, but at the end the truth will triumph because it is supported by the god daivamundedu. That is what it says, the god will support. Now what is the format of this particular poem? That is more interesting to me. It is called a utpalamala. Now utpalamala, if you want to write a poem in Utpalamala, you have to know two things, that any syllable in Telugu language is either a short syllable or a long syllable denoted by a line or a U. So in, and these syllables are grouped together. If you have a long syllable and two short syllables, it is called bha gana. Then if you have a long syllable, short syllable, and a long syllable, a ra, and so on. And in order to write a utpalamala, you should follow this gana vibhajana, and you have to write it in as bha, ra, na, bha, Bharava. That means whatever the poem that you see here would follow the, if you try to note those syllables, you would end up with these ganas in all the four lines. Also, there is a strict, say, repetition of the second word everywhere, ra, sarapu, barapu, varva, staraka, and so on. Like that, there are many different kinds of poems. Champakamala, where the ganavibhajana is najabhaja jajara, and for Matteba, it is sabharana mayava, and for Sardula, it is masajasa tataga. So what do I mean? If you want to write any of the poems, and if you write with these ganavibhajana, as it is called, you would fall into any of these kinds of poems. But this, you can see, is very rigid in its nature. There are many more. I have just chosen the simplest of the examples. Now, with these rigid, say, chandas and all, even with all these rigid chandas and all, let me rephrase it. In Telugu, poetry had a very great literary past, starting from, say, the Kavitraya, then Palakurki Somanadha, Nache, Nanne Choda, Nachana Somana, Srinadha, who is considered one of the most difficult poets to read, he translated all the works of Sriharsha, and many of you might know that Naishadam Vidvadaushadam, it is a difficult pill to swallow, and Srinadha was able to go swallow that and also give it to the Telugu audience. And then we have Potana, who wrote Andhra Mahabhagavata. Potana is a special case because all the other poets that I mentioned here had king's patronage. And Potana was a farmer, and he refused king's patronage, saying that he in his dream, Saraswati, goddess Saraswati, came and wept that, would you sell me to a king? Okay, so that's the kind of a person Potana was, and his Andhra Mahabhagavatam is an excellent piece of literature, and especially Dasamaskandam, I would recommend anybody who wants to read Telugu literature, Andhra Mahabhagavatam, Dasamaskandam, where he describes Krishna Leelalu, is brilliant. Then we have Vijayanagara Empire. The main king himself, Krishnadevaraya, was a poet in Telugu. He wrote Amukta Malyada, and his Ashtadiggajas, including Peddana, who wrote Manucharitra, and the famous one whom many of us know is Tenali Rama. He was a part of those Ashtadiggajas. He wrote, he was not only a poet, and but he also wrote very serious poetry in Telugu called Panduranga Mahatyam. Then we do have Satakas, folklore, bhakti songs, and other different forms of poetry. And one of the important Satakas in Telugu is of Vemana. Sataka means 100 poems, which end with the same end line. Okay, so Vemana and Annamaya, that is, he belonged to the bhakti as well as folklore genre. Most of the poets stuck to pedantic style, except Vemana and Annamaya. Even in Vemana's poems, we do see the strict followance to, or strict adherence to the grammar. But he moved away from the language that was used, the pedantic language. But he still used the grammar. Okay, and we also had a great tradition of women poets in Telugu, starting from Talapaka Timmakka, who was, Annamaya's wife, Molla, who wrote Ramayana, Rangajamma, Mudupallani, Ramabhadramma, Vengumamba. And also we have some unique literary forms in Telugu, that is Avadhana, where a person, the Avadhani, as he is called, sits in the center and is surrounded by 8 or sometimes 100 or sometimes 1,000 people, asking different questions and he has to answer them extempore in poetry. And then at the end of the whole program, he has to repeat the entire poetry that he extemporally said in the for these 100 or 1,000 or 8 people. Ashtavadana, Satavadana or Sahasravadana are they are called. And also there is a special type of poetry in Telugu called Dvardhi Kavya, which is that if you read the poem in one way, it represents one kind of a story. And if you break the words, then it will become a different story altogether. So there are at least a couple of Dvardhi Kavyas, I know. And one of my teachers in my college days, intermediate college days, wrote one of them. His book was Esu Krishniyam. That means if you read the poem in one way, it would tell the life story of Jesus. And if you read it one way, it would tell the story of Krishna, Lord Krishna. Also, because Telugu is a language which ends in vowels, like in Italian, it is very affable to music. So there are many musicians in Telugu, starting from Tyagaraya, Annamaya, Kshetraya, and Ramadasa, to name a few. And also art forms are rich in Andhra or in Telugu language. Kuchipudi, which used the music composed by some of these musicians mentioned above. Yakshagana, which also exists in Kannada. And we also have, say, theater, and especially a form called Padyanataka, where the poems in the great poet, the great books like Andhra Mahabharata or Mahabhagavata were made into a kind of drama, and those poems were made popular in these plays. This is the setup up to almost the beginning of 19th century for say Telugu language. And during the early 19th century and second half of 19th century, modern literature, especially because of the spread of, say, Christian missionaries in the Andhra, deep Andhra belt, caused what is known as the lingua franca movement. That is to use common language for writing or representing any art form. And the person to lead this particular movement was Kandukuri Virasalingam from Rajahmundry. He was considered as great social reformer. And Gurajada Apparao, who wrote the first ever, say, Vyangya Nataka called Kanyasulka, Kanyasulkam, where he, made fun of the then existing child marriages and the child marriages. And then we have Gidigu Ramamurthy Panthulu, who emphasized that if you want to empathize with common people, you should express yourself in the language of the common people, not a higher plane language which they cannot understand. And many others like Chilakamurthy Lakshminarasimham Panthulu, Panaganti Lakshminarasimharao followed the ideas of the above three. And we had the beginning of what is known as the lingua franca movement. And during the same period, influenced by the Western philosophy and Western romantic poets, we had a romantic poetry movement in Andhra, whose players were Rayaprolu Subbarao, Devulpalli Krishna Shastri, Nayana Subbarao, Nanduri Subbarao, Gurram Joshua, and many more. But the main important book in this particular time was Krishna Paksham by Krishna Shastri, Devulpalli Krishna Shastri. But here I have to stress that even in these poems, the style was still semi-pedantic. They still used the different forms of poems that I mentioned earlier, and they were not still say free to write in the so-called lingua franca or vaduka bhasha. And in this setup, we have the progressive movement, which spanned for about 20 years. It was an antithesis to the romantic poetry movement, in the sense that romantic spoke about themselves and their pain, and progressives spoke about others and the pain of others. And Marxism became the ideology of this poetry, and it called whoever who wrote in pedantic style, capitalists or friends of capitalists, and they dreamt for an egalitarian society. And this poetry influenced a few generations of poets from all ranks of society, and Sri Sri and his Mahaprasthanam embodies both progressive as well as the lingua franca movements. Now, something about Sri Sri. What is he basically? Srirangam Srinivasa Rao, as popularly known as Sri Sri, was born as Pudipeddi Srinivasa Rao to Pudipeddi Venkatraman Ramanayya and Appalakonda in Vishakhapatnam in 1910. And he was adopted by his mother's side uncle and became Srirangam, the mother's side uncle Srirangam Suryanarayana, and he became Srirangam Srinivasa Rao. He was married twice at the age of 15 and later at the age of 49 to two different women. And what we know of his education was he completed his higher education in Visakhapatnam and went to Madras Christian College to pursue BA in Zoology. And after completing this particular degree, he went back to Visakhapatnam and did many odd jobs, like a timekeeper in the Visakhapatnam courtyard, waiting clerk in the same place, a lab demonstrator in a college, a newsreader in AIR, and even an editor of a magazine. But he, because of his independent thought processes, he could not stay in any one job stably. He then went to Chennai or Madras then and started working in movies. He wrote many dubbing movies and countless movie songs. After his popularity as a poet shoot, he became a member of Pen India, which was a part of Sahitya Academy. He also was the vice president of South Indian Film Writers Association and the president of Revolutionary Writers Association of Andhra Pradesh. Then he won several awards, including Soviet Land Nehru Award in 1966, Rajya Lakshmi Foundation Award, Sahitya Academy Award in 1972, National Film Award for Best Lyrics in Telugu 1974. And his important creations were Prabhava, compilation of poems, Mahaprasthanam, compilation of poems, Maro Prapancham, which is stories, Charamaratri, a collection of stories, Khadga Srishti, poems, Sri Sri Samagra Sahityam, when he was 60 years, his Sastipurti, as we call it in Telugu, was conducted in Kakinada of Andhra Pradesh in a very big way, and in that all his existing books were made into one complete compendium, and it is called Sri Sri Sahityam. Okay, it contains everything. Maro Prasthanam, Vyasa Kridalu, which is essays, Praja, question answers, he conducted in a popular magazine, Anantam, his own autobiography. We can consider, there are many more, but I consider these as his important contributions. And he died on 15th June in 1983 in Chennai. And as I mentioned, his funeral was a sight that many would envy, I would believe. where his poems were being read when his pyre was let up. Now, about Mahaprasthanam itself, which is the main theme of our today's book reading. The Mahaprasthanam book has influences from Nazrul Islam, who is a Bengali poet, Swinburne, an English poet, E.A. Poe, an English poet, Marx and Engels, Das Kapital, that is the basis of Marxism, First Manifesto of Progressive Writers Association, adopted in the Foundation Conference in 1936, which was signed by people like Syed Sajjad Jahir, Ahmad Ali, Mulkraj Anand, Rashid Jena, and Mahu Majumdar. Sorry, I get this name wrong. And also, it is influenced by the Hegelian dialect, or some people say, or of Kant, the German philosophers, which is that any new idea starts with a thesis, it is opposed with an antithesis, and then this both thesis and antithesis will mingle and form what is known as the synthesis of an idea. So this particular Mahaprasthanam follows in some of the poems, these ideas are followed. And many more Russian and European writers have influenced the book. Also, Sri Sri himself says that there was a rehearsal of sorts of the Second World War in 1930s, where there was an internal war in Spain, where many poets, Adon, Spender, De Luis, Dylan Thomas, George Barker, these poets went and fought this particular war, and those tales reached parts of the world and especially India too, and influenced the poems of Sri Sri. No surprises that the color of these poems is red. And what is the speciality in the writings of Mahaprasthanam? The speciality in writings of Mahaprasthanam is, since Sri Sri was born as a Brahmin and was brought up with Brahminical practices until his 15, 16 years, he was deeply into those lingua. So the language that is used in Mahaprasthanam uses many words from Puranas and the Brahminic practices, but to complete opposite, or to give complete different connotation, that is Marxist connotation. Okay, the words socialism and communism are never mentioned in Mahaprasthanam, but the symbols like the red flag, the symbols of labor, everything that we now associate with communism and Marxism are everywhere splattered around in Mahaprasthanam. Now, the book itself was in Vaduka Bhasha, as I mentioned, and there was no rigid grammar that was followed. The most important book that started this particular thing, that rigid grammar is not necessary for wonderful poetry, was Mahaprasthanam, I could say. And it had no prosodic constraints, if I'm not wrong, the word prosodic, I'm not able to pronounce it correctly, sorry.
Prosodic.
Prosodic, thank you. Thank you, sir. Prosodic constraints, and the chandas that Sri Sri followed was matra chandas. So it's only lyrical, but did not follow any strict rules in the writing. The number of poems in this collection are about 40 poems and one dedication poem. Because the book was dedicated to Kompella Janardhana Rao, a budding poet and publisher of Udayini, who was publishing then progressive writers' poems. And what is the period in which these poems were written? Mostly in 1930s. These 1930s were called the Hungry 30s. There was, in the late 1920s, there was the Great Depression. World was in turmoil. India in freedom struggle. There was joblessness, hunger in almost entire Europe and America, except the bright spot that they saw then was the Soviet Russia, which was progressing with, say, its own five-year plans, which inspired many of these poets. And the first year, but the book took a lot of time to come. These poems were published in local magazines, Telugu magazines of that time. And they were compiled and formed into a book only in 1950. And the greatest poem of the collection people consider is Kavita O Kavita, means poem O poem. And even today, even if you talk to any Telugu literary critic, he would say probably it is still the greatest modern poem ever written in the lingua franca. The popular poems of this particular book are Mahaprasthanam, the first poem, which is the title of the book as well, Desa Charitralu, that means Desa Charitralu, Jagannadhara Chakralu, I, Jayabheri, Rukkulu, Navakavita, Advaitam, Sandhya Samasyalu, Pratignya, Midhyavadi, Aha, Batasari, Avataram. I chose some of them with my own, whatever I felt were very popular, but many others feel some more poems are also as important. And the book does not have a formal foreword as such, but it has a Yogyata Patram. Yogyata Patram would mean, say, it has a two sets of connotations. One is by Chalam. Yes, sir?
Certificate.
Not exact. It is a certificate of, say, your own, whether you are eligible to read this is one way of looking at it. And the other way of looking at it is that this particular book is a yogya. It's a very great book. Okay, so there are two connotations to that Yogyata Patram. By Chalam, who was a great disruptive feminist writer par excellence. I'll start, and also say, these are some of the critiques or critique of Mahaprasthanam that I found in, by, say, K. Srinivasa Sastri, in a book published by Sahitya Academy. He says, Sri Sri strikes different notes at different times. There is sadness, despair, indignation, self-criticism, self-gratulation, robust optimism, defiance. All these different notes register their relevance in the firm and precise control he achieves over the flow of his song. Even as he defies the crippling effects of his misery and pain, he makes the pain and problems of others his own and integrates them all into his impassioned yet controlled harmonies. That's one form, one part. The themes of revolution does not figure in Mahaprasthanam, as I mentioned, as a mere intellectual principle or an emotional outburst. The poet combines intellectual conviction with emotional depth as he develops his ideas on revolution and its relevance to the establishment of a new social order. The passion behind his experience and expressions give individuality and permeance to his felt ideas on revolution. So that is the critique of Mahaprasthanam. And it continues to say, we notice that blending of passion and thought, keen social consciousness, combination of everyday speech, rhythms and idioms with the facilities of poetic diction, controlled melodies and economy of expression are among Sri Sri's varied accomplishments in Mahaprasthanam. is one of the first modern poets in Telugu who had adopted thus a society-oriented stance and employed patterns of everyday speech for poetic purposes. Also, the simplicity he achieves cannot be achieved easily, though it appears to be effortless, and the simplicity of his melody is inseparably connected to the economy of his expression. This is what I thought was the best way of, or the best criticism I found of, or best critique of Sri Sri's work I found. And now I start with introducing you to the book itself now. It starts with Chalam's Yogyata Patram. In this, say, Chalam defines the poetry of Sri Sri as a battle cry that a poet makes till he achieves a compromise between his inner self and the world around him. With blood and tears, Sri Sri created his new poetry as a tonic to the ailments of the world. Also, he continues to say, the poems are the streams of blood flowing directly from the poet's heart to those of the readers. Okay. Also, I found these three paragraphs very interesting. He says, Chalam says, Krishna Sastri, the romantic poet, say, Tana Bhada Andarlonu Palikiste, Sri Sri Andare Bhadanu Tanalo Palikistadu, means Sri Sri's, Krishna Sastri's pain is everybody's pain, whereas everybody's pain is Sri Sri's pain. That's what is the essence of this paragraph. And Chalam then say, true to the title Yogyata Patram, it says, read Sri Sri Pustakam Koni Tiriga Chadavandi, read the book in leisurely. Padyam Padisarlu Chadavandi, read it 10 times. If you are not able to understand, give it to a youth or even a beggar or a patient on a deathbed, but don't throw it away. Please pass it on. Okay, this is a poet and a poetry collection which is going to rule the next generation of Telugu poetry. So please, this is a great energy in your hand. Please pass it on. If you want to still read the book, if you still want to read the book, wait for 10 years. Padellu agandi. ఈ లోపల ఆస్తి సంపాదించడం, పిల్లల్ని కనడం, ధరలు హెచ్చడం, జీవితంలో ఇంకా ఏవైనా మిమ్మల్ని అమితంగా ఇన్ఫ్లుయెన్స్ చేసినవి జరిగి ఉంటే మళ్ళీ కొత్త కాపీని కొని శ్రీశ్రీ పద్యాలను చదవండి. అప్పుడన్నా అర్థమవుతుందేమో. మీన్స్ హీస్ టెలింగ్ వెయిట్ ఫర్ 10 మోర్ ఇయర్స్, దెన్ బై దెన్ యూ వుడ్ హ్యావ్ ఫినిష్డ్ ఎర్నింగ్ యువర్ ఇనఫ్ మనీ, యూ వుడ్ హ్యావ్ ఫినిష్డ్ ద రెస్పాన్సిబిలిటీస్ ఆఫ్ యువర్ చిల్డ్రన్, యూ వుడ్ హ్యావ్ సీన్ ఇన్ఫ్లేషన్ అండ్ డిఫ్లేషన్ and many other aspects of life. Maybe then, if you are able to read Sri Sri again, maybe you will be able to understand a bit of him. Swayanga chadavandi, don't, please read it on your own. Then don't get any, don't get any opinion from anybody else. Please read Sri Sri on your own. It's contrary to what I am doing. That's why I got along. And if you have the guts to hear Rabandula Rekkala Chappudu, Payodhara Prachanda Ghosham, Jumjhanila Shajjadvanam, meaning if you are able to listen to the wings of the vultures or the wind that is coming, that is sweeping the world, or are you able to listen to the ocean sounds and are able to bear them, then only read this or start reading this book. That's exactly what Chalam says. You can imagine the kind of popularity the book has. Mahaprasthanam, Chalam's Yogyata Patram also has that kind of popularity in Telugu literature, because it is straight to the point and it is appealing directly to the reader, whether and only if you have guts read the book. If not, please close it and pass it on to others. So that's the kind of Yogyata Patram Chalam gave it to this particular book. Now, coming to the poems of Mahaprasthanam. I have chosen 10 poems, but I will maybe read a few of them. But first, I want you to listen to Sri Sri himself reading his Mahaprasthanam, the great forward march. Poem, Sri Sri is calling upon the people to start moving forward, march forward towards a new world where he believes that that particular world has a better place for everyone. That's the simplest essence of this particular poem, I would say. But I have kept the original translation by himself, Sri Sri, for you to read. Where he uses the first time, a red flag, which clearly indicates what is the flavor of this particular set of poems, communism and Marxism. Okay, and then comes the next poem. Jaya Bheri. Probably many of us are aware of this particular poem because it was used in couple of movies as Telugu people. We might know it as it was used in couple of movies, but as movie song. But this particular poem, Jaya Bheri, is a poem which says, I want to contribute to the world. I want to contribute to the world I want to give a samidha to the prapancha agni. So the poem says, Nenu saitam prapancha agni ki samidhanokkati ahutichanu, Nenu saitam visva srushti ki asruvokkati dharavosanu, Nenu saitam bhuvana ghoshaku verri gontuka vrichi mosanu. Meaning, I too have added fuel to the fire of the world. I too have given a tear to the cyclonic storm of the world. I too have added my wild voice to the roar of the world. Okay. And then he continues to say, when the summer's blazing sun scorched the earth, I too burnt like an owl. When the rains drenched the soil, I too have turned into the drops of water flowing freely. When the winter's biting cold ceased, I too screamed, freezing and hungry. But if I stop in my tracks, blazing winds, rainy clouds, and snowflakes will turn into ashes on this earth. The colorful stars that peep from the sky explode, and rain down bleeding. All days shatter. All nights shut down, engulfing the world within a great deluge. I alone will occupy the whole world. A time will come when my crooning tunes fill the world. I too will blossom as a white petal in the flower of the world. I too will become a string in the veena of the world and lose myself in its music. I too will rise and flutter as a flag atop the palace of the world. I like the last words really, really. And they are like inspiration to me. Nenu saitam prapanchabjapu tellarekai pallavistanu. Nenu saitam visvaveenaku tantrini murjanalu potanu. Nenu saitam bhuvana bhavanapu bautanai paiki lestanu. These words are an inspiration to me. Then he talks about the kind of objects for poetry. Earlier, every poem, you could not write poetry about anything and everything. But according to Sri Sri, even a puppy or a matchstick or a bread or even a peel of banana or a table or even a door bolt or a harati tray or a horse rein, anything could be an object of poetry. But what do you need to write poetry? You should have poetic inspiration to look at things and be able to write something about them. And if you have the necessary sight, then you will be able to write the necessary word. The world is a maze and poetry is a thirst that is unquenchable. So that's what he talks about in this poem called Rukkulu. I will read it in Telugu. The translation is here. Kukkapilla agipulla sabbubilla heenanga chudaku denni kavitamayamoy anni rotte makka ariti tokka balla chekka niveepe chustu untai tamulotu kanukkomantai talupu gollem harati pallem gurrapu kallem kaadedi kavita kanarham avunovunu silpam anargham ఉండాలోయ్ కవితావేశం కానీ ఓయ్ రసనిర్దేశం దొరకతటోయ్ శోభాలేశం కళ్ళంటూ ఉంటే చూసి వాక్కుంటే వ్రాసి ప్రపంచమొక పద్మవ్యూహం కవిత్వమొక తీరని దాహం. దట్స్ వాట్ పోయిట్ దట్స్ వాట్ హీ టాక్ థింగ్స్ అబౌట్ డిఫరెంట్ పోయిటిక్ థీమ్స్ దట్ కెన్ అరేస్ ఫ్రమ్ నార్మల్ డే టు డే లైఫ్. దెన్ హీ టాక్స్ అబౌట్ రెవల్యూషన్ ఇన్ ఎ వెరీ poetic Brahmanic and Puranic manner. He says, imagine a time or a point when all the Vahanas of the gods start revolting against the gods themselves. Okay, so let us assume or let us imagine if the buffalo of Yama starts revolting against Yama, or the ferocious canines of the hell, say they unleash themselves, or the seven horses of the sun, okay, revolt against the sun itself, or the lion of Kanaka Durga turns against her, or the elephant of the Indra is challenging Indra himself, or Nandikesa is fighting against Shiva, and so on. And he says, if these things happen, then there will be labor pains for Mother Earth and it will herald a new birth. Which means he's in a sense talking about the lower class or lower rung of society revolting against their masters to create, or then only he says there will be a new birth or the new society that is created. That's the essence of this particular poem. And about self, he talks about himself in these three poems. He says, Bhutani means Bhutam has two connotations. One is like in part of Panchabhuta, or a representative of the Kala himself, the Kalam, okay, that is time. భూతాన్ని యజ్ఞోపవీతాన్ని వైప్లవ్య గీతాన్ని నేను స్మరిస్తే పద్యం. ఇఫ్ ఐ థింక్ ఐ రైట్ ఐ గెట్ ఎ పోయమ్. ఇఫ్ ఐ షౌట్ ఇట్ ఈస్ వాద్యం. అరిస్తే వాద్యం అనల వేదిక ముందు అస్త్ర నైవేద్యం, లోకాలు భవభూతి శ్లోకాలు, పరమేష్టి జూకాలు, నా మహోద్రేకాలు, నా ఊహ చాంపేయమాల, రసరాజ్య డోల, నా ఊహ ఊళ కేదార గౌళ, గిరులు సాగర్లు కంకేళికా మంజరులు, ఝరులు నా సోదరులు, నేనొక దుర్గం, నాదొక స్వర్గం, అనర్గళం అనితర సాధ్యం నా మార్గం. Leaving out all the other lines, the last three lines are prophetic in nature. It says, Nenoka Durgam, I am a fort. Nadoka Swargam, mine is a heaven. And Anargalam, I mean, non-stop, I can write poetry non-stop. Anitara Sadhyam, it is unparalleled. My style is unparalleled. And till date, it remains so. And he talks about his critics. Nippulu chimmukuntu ningiki nen egiripothe nibidaascharyamto veeru, nettulu krakkukuntu nelaku raalipothe nirdhakshinyanga veere. Means, if I fly sky high, throwing sparks of fire, wonderstruck they, if I crash down bleeding profusely, mercilessly, the same day. Meaning, if I perform greatly, they are wonderstruck. If I do any mistake, they will criticize me mercilessly. That's what he says. And then he is self-indulgent in this poem. Deni koraku velakani velalalo lenipoli vanchalato darikani darulalo kanarani kaankshalato deni koraku pade pade devulaadtav aakatito alasatato praakulaadtav Srinivasarao. He is talking to himself. Srinivasarao, deni kosamoi నడిన నడిరాత్రి కడలి వద్ద హోరుగాలి ఉపశ్రుతిగా నీలోనే నీవు అలసించుతావు, అవ్యక్త కుతూహలతో ఆలసించుతావు, జగమంతా నిద్ర మునిగి సద్దణిగిన నడిరాత్రి నీలోనే నీవేదో ఆలకించుతావు. శ్రీనివాసరావు మీనింగ్ హీస్ టెలింగ్ హౌ హీ స్పెండ్స్ లేట్ నైట్స్ టు లిజన్ టు హిస్ ఇన్నర్ వాయిసెస్ టు బి ఏబుల్ టు రైట్ పోయట్రీ. దెన్ he talks about in this particular poem Pratignya, the vow. He talks about I will create a new song for all the people who are working class, let me put it that way. So he says the farmer who is using plows to plow the field, and the karmika who is in a mine, the mine worker, to a rickshaw wala, to all the labor who are working in different forms, okay, I will listen to them and I will write a new song, and I pledge that I will create poetry for you. This is exactly what he says in this particular poem. And he says the future Vedas are going to come from these life experiences. Okay, so the important lines of this particular poem are that polalananni halaladunni ilatalamlo hemam pindaga jaganikanta saukhyam nindaga virama merugaka parisraminche balam daritriki baliga avinche karshaka veerula kayam ninda kaluvu katte dharmajalaniki kharidu ledo, which means there is no price for the sweat that comes out of the people who work in the fields or in mines or in many other say vritti, as he calls it. So this is about labor, and he is respecting the labor, and he is telling that there is no price that can be paid for the sweat and toil they put in to make our lives better. Then he comes on to talk about the histories of the world. This particular poem is very famous because it simply says that you should not look at history from the eyes of the kings, the queens, and their life histories and all, but from the common man's perspective. So he says, e desa charitra chusina emunnadi garva karanam Narajati Charitra Samastam Parapidana Parayanatvam, which means that all that you get in history books is the oppression of one kind of humans on others. That's the basic point in this particular poem. And he then says, these are the important words of the poem. Takshashila Pataliputram, Madhyadhara Samudratiram, Harappa Mohenjadaro, Tromanyan Guhamohallo, Charitrika Vibhata Sandhyala, Manavakada Vikasamettidi, Ye Desam Ye Kalamlo, Sadhinchina De Paramardham, Ye Silpam Ye Sahityam, Ye Sastram Ye Gandharvam, Ye Vellula Ki Prasthanam, Ye Swapnam Ye Digvijayam. Which means, if you want to understand poetry, you should be able to look at these things. Look at the great Takshashila or the Pataliputra. What did the common man do in those particular places? Or what did people in the Mediterranean, near the Mediterranean Sea, do? Or what did the people in Harappa and Mohenjo-daro do? What did the humans in Cro-Magnon caves do? Or what was their art? What was their poetry? What was their science? What did they achieve? Where did they move from in terms of human human pedestals? That means, did they move from did they climb the stairs of humanity? Is what you should be looking at, and not Erani Prema Puranam, or that means you should not be looking at what Rani's love affair was or other such things. So that is the poem E Desa Charitra Chusina. Okay, it is, and also this poem gives us an essence of how international thought Sri Sri had. I would end the thing with the last poem, maybe. That is him by Sri Sri himself again.
Yes.
Kavita O Kavita. This is considered as the greatest poem till date. And I want you to listen to Sri Sri himself while the translation is on.
కవితా ఓ కవిత నా యువకాశల సుమపేశల నవగీతావరణంలో నిను నేనొక సుముహూర్తంలో అతి సుందర సుస్యందనమందున దూరంగా విను వీధులలో విహరించే అందని అందానివిగా భావించిన రోజులలో నీకై బ్రతుకే ఒక తప్పమై వెదుకాడే నిమిషాలందు నిషాలందున ఇటునే చూచిన చిటులాలంకారపు మటుమాయల నటనలలో నీ రూపం కనరానందున నాకువలో కుటిలో చీకటిలో ఒక్కడనై సుక్కిన రోజులు లేవా నీ ప్రాబల్యంలో చిరదీక్షా శిక్షా తపస్సమీక్షణలో నిశ్చల సమాధిలో సర్గద్వారపు తోరణమై రైలిన నా మస్తిష్కంలో ఏ ఘోషలు భాషలు దృశ్యాలు తోచాయో నేనే ఏ చిత్ర విచిత్ర శ్యమంత రోచిర్నివహం చూశానో నా గీతం ఏ శక్తులలో ప్రాణస్పందన పొందిందో నీకై నేనేరిన వేయధ్వనులో ఏ మూలల వెతకిన ప్రోగుల రణం నినాదాలో నడివే ఆట సమావర్తించిన మేఘాలు ఆవర్షించిన ప్రచండ శంఖా ప్రపంచనం గజగజలాలించిన నరిసంద్రపు కెరటాల్లో మోగిన శంఖారావం ఢంకాధ్వానం ఆ రాత్రే కారడుగులలో ఉలయాతీతమై విరిపించిన నానా జంతుధ్వనులో నక్షత్రాంతర నిబిడ నిఖిలగానం భూకంపాలు ప్రభుత్వ పతనాలు విప్లవం యుద్ధం అన్నీ నీ చైతన్యం నీ విశ్వరూప సాక్షాత్కారం మరి నిన్ను స్మరిస్తే నాకు అగుపించే దృశ్యాల వినిపించే భాష్యాల అగ్ని సరస్సున వికసించిన వజ్రం ఎగిరే లోహశ్యేనం ఫిరంగిలో జ్వరం ధరించే మృదంగనాదం ఇంకా నేనేం విన్నానా నడిరే నిద్రలో అప్పుడే ప్రసవించిన శిశువు నడదు నిలుపుకొని రుచిర స్వప్నాలను కాంచే జవరాది మన ప్రపంచపు ప్రావర్తాలు శిశువు చిత్ర నిద్రలో ప్రాచీన స్మృతులు చే చప్పులు వైద్యశాలలో శస్త్రకారుని మహేంద్రజాలంలో చావు బతుకుల సంచార కాలంలో కన్నులు మూసిన రోగార్తుని రక్తనాళ సంస్పందన కాలువ నీళ్ళలో జారిపడి కదలగనైనా చాలని త్రాగుబోతు వ్యక్తావ్య కాలాపన ప్రేలాపన కడుపు దహించుకుపోయే పడుపు కత్తి రాక్షసరతిలో అర్ధ నిమీలిత నేత్రాల భయంకర బాధల పాటల పల్లవి ఉరితీయబడ్డ శిరస్సు చెప్పిన రహస్యం ఉన్మాది మన శనివాదిలో కూకం కేకా కూకం కేక ఫేకం బాక సమ్మె కట్టిన కూలీల భార్యల బిడ్డల ఆకటి చీకటి చిచ్చుల హాహాకారం ఆర్తారావం ఒక లక్ష నక్షత్రాల మాటలు ఒక కోటి జలపాతాల పాటలు శతకోటి సముద్ర తరంగాల మ్రోతలు విన్నానమ్మా విన్నానెన్నో విన్నాను నా విన్నవి కన్నవి విన్నవించగా మాటలకే విధుకారకపోతే అవి పుంఖాను పుంఖంగా శ్మశానాల వంటి నిఘంటువులు దాటి ఛందస్సుల సర్ప పరిష్వంగం వదలి వ్యాకరణాల సంఖ్యలు విడిచి వడిగా వడివడిగా వెలువడినై పరివిడినైనా ఎదన రిగిడినై ఆ చెలరేగిన కలగాపులగపు విలయావర్త ఉపలవత్ చరవత్ పరివర్తనలో నేనే ఏ వీధులలో చంక్రమణం చేశానో నా సృష్టించిన గానంలో ప్రక్షాళిత మామక పాప పరంపరలు ఆనంద వశంవద హృదయుని చేస్తే నీకై మేలుకొనిన సకలేంద్రియములతో ఏది రచిస్తున్నానో చూస్తున్నానో ఊపిరి తీస్తున్నానో నిర్వికల్ప సమాధిలో నా ప్రాణం నిర్వాణం పొందిందో అటు నన్ను మంత్రించిన సముద్ధం కావించిన గాంధర్వానికి తారానివహ ప్రేమ సమాగమంలో జన్మించిన సంగీతానికి నా నాడుల తీగలపై సాగిన నాదబ్రహ్మపు పరిచుంబనలో ప్రాణావసాన వేళాజనితం నానా గానానూన స్వానావళితం బ్రతుకును ప్రచండ పేరుండ గరు పరిరంభంలో పట్టిన గానం సుఖ దుఃఖాదిక ద్వంద్వాతీతం అమోఘ మగాధం అచింత్యం అమేయం ఏకాంతం ఏకైకం క్షణికమై శాశ్వతమైన దివ్యానుభవం బ్రహ్మానుభవం కలిగించిన నన్ను కలిగించిన కవనకృణి రమణి కవిత ఓ కవిత నా జనని గర్భంలో ఆకారం లేకుండా నిద్రిస్తున్న నా అహంకారానికి ఆకలి కుల్పించిన నాడో నా బహిరంగేంద్రియాలలో ప్రాణం ప్రసరించగలిగి భూలోకంలో పడి సుఖదుఖాలేవేవో వస్తుంటే తలదాలికి ప్రపంచ పరిణాహంలో ప్రయాణికుడనై పరివ్రాజికుడనై విఫలంగా వర్తించే వేళ అభయహస్త ముద్రతో నన్ను ధరిసిన నన్ను పునీతుని కావించిన కవిత లలిత లలిత కరుణా మహిత అనుపమిత కవిత అనుపమిత అపరిమిత కవిత ఓ కవిత నేడో నా ఊహాంకెల సాహసికాంశం కప్పిన నా నిట్టూర్పులు వినిపిస్తాయా నేనేదో విరచిస్తానని నా రచనలలో లోకం ప్రతిఫలించి నా తపస్సు ఫలించి నా గీతం గుండెలలో కూర్నెల్లగా నా జాతి జనులు పాడుకునే మంత్రంగా మృగించాలని నా ఆకాశాలను లోకానికి చేరువగా నా ఆదర్శాలను సోదరులంతా పంచుకునే వెలుగుల రవ్వల జడిగా అంది అందకపోయే నీ చేరాంచలముల విసులుల కొసగాలులతో నిర్మించిన నా నుడి నీ గుడిగా నా గీతం నైవేద్యంగా నృత్యంగా అర్పిస్తానో నా విసరిన రస విసుమర కుసుమ పరాగం ఓహో ఓ రసని మణిఖని జనని ఓ కవిత 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 ఓ కవిత
యా దిస్ ఇస్ ద ఇన్ఫ్లుయెన్స్ ఆఫ్ మహాప్రస్థానం ఆన్ ద సొసైటీ ఐ స్టాప్ హియర్
థ్యాంక్ యూ వెరీ మచ్ వండర్ఫుల్ శివ థ్యాంక్ యూ వెరీ మచ్ ఫర్ అ గ్లిమ్స్ ఇన్ టు తెలుగు లిటరేచర్ అండ్ ఫర్ దిస్ వెరీ comprehensive and energetic peek into a Mahaprasthanam. I think we can take some questions or any comments that any of you may want to have for Shiva.
All his poetry is like this, is it? The way you have said, it's all about human predicament. It's all about the common man. It's all about injustice. And then there comes the part where there is hope for the future, a vision, and essentially revolutionary poetry kind of thing. Is it that or?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Are there other themes also?
In this particular book, Mahaprasthanam, mainly the themes are what you have mentioned, but there are certain poems, like one poem, Advaitam, which is, say, people consider it as one of the great romantic poems, but in the philosophical mode, and also then there are translations of different poets. Say, for example, of the French as well as Swedish, Spanish poets. In another book called Khadgasrushti, there he wrote many different forms of poetry. So Sri Sri is not limited to just revolution or revolutionary type of poems, but he has a large span, but he's mainly known for his revolutionary ideas or poems. And it is said that the Naxal movement in Andhra owes a lot to his book Mahaprasthanam. It was the first book that any new student in, say, people call now the NET Warangal, REC Warangal then, would have. And it produced many of them just ran away reading Sri Sri's poems into forests and became Naxals. That's the kind of influence he had on people, they say.
Okay.
Okay, I think there are some comments from Sujit. Sujit had to leave at 5, but he has said, please convey my compliments to Shiva. It was a candid and beautiful session, very characteristic of his style. And at one point, he also said very beautiful words, intense and humble at the same time. I would feel there's also a strong touch of romanticism in the thoughts.
Thanks, Shiva. Really enjoyed it. I just had one question. When you were introducing the poet and his work, you mentioned that he was very influenced by the thesis, antithesis, synthesis structure. So I was just curious. I understand what that means somewhat in other contexts, but in poetry, what would that look like? And is that
I can show you one example. So this is a poem, Jagannadhuni Radha Chakralu, means the wheels of the Radha of Jagannatha in Puri. Okay. So he says initially that the normal idea is that these Radha Chakras are what the Jagannatha's Radha Chakras represent, the elite. Okay. So are the property of the elite. You normal humans or normal low-level people could not touch this particular Radha as it was moving. That was my understanding. So he says, I will bring this particular Radha Chakra, which is flying in the air, to ground. Then he says a lot more. And then finally he says, see, they have arrived. Now they are listening to you also. So the whole poem, if I could read, the essence of, say, first the thesis that these are unachievable to you, are unreachable to you, then the antithesis that I will bring them down, and then the synthesis that both of you will coexist, but they will work for you now. Okay. So that kind of, completeness in the poem is there.
Thanks, Shiva.
So if there are no more questions, we can call it a day. Thank you very much for an excellent presentation, excellent talk, very comprehensive in terms of glimpses into the entire 20th century, late 19th century Telugu literature, the movement that led to a work like Mahaprasthanam attaining the kind of importance in Telugu literature that it did, and the words of Shri Shri, as well as your very passionately presented energetic words. Thank you very much, Shiva, for beautifully carrying on this book reading session. We can probably have a round of applause wherever we are for whatever you have presented today. And thank you very much, everyone, for coming back for this session.